I'm Ed Amoroso from Tag Cyber, and I'm here with my friend Toby Weir Jones, who works at Bayshore Networks, and we're going to talk today about maritime cybersecurity. That sounds really interesting.
That's right. We're gonna talk about sort of the interesting thing with ships and vessels and offshore industrial platforms.
So before we do that, a little bit on Bayshore. What do you guys do?
So Bayshore provides inline protection for industrial environments. And as we're about to discover, it doesn't matter if they're on land or at sea. You know, they're all using the same types of production equipment and control systems. And what we try to do is ensure that they can't be taken over, they can't be misused from unauthorized sources, and they don't end up running amok because the connectivity and complexity of those networks is just increasing every day.
Inline means you're an active participant, right? You're
not
sitting off on the side.
That's right. So the crucial thing for Bayshore is we sit in line and look at this native activity and make decisions about what's safe and acceptable and filter out everything that's dangerous.
So you have to understand all of that.
We do.
It's a combination of industrial and operational technology and cyber.
That's right. So what we're looking at is not only a really deep understanding of the communications protocols and all this industrial equipment, but also how an attacker might get into the structure of those protocols and take advantage of them, how to do something dangerous that the protocol designers never anticipated because these were always believed to be closed, trusted systems.
Interesting. How'd you guys get into that line of work? How do you do, have you been doing OT for a long time?
Yeah, absolutely. The company's been around about 7 years, so we're pretty well vetted at this point. The whole idea was we knew that these industrial networks were getting more and more connected. And yet we saw that the human capital gap, the skills necessary to really make immediate decisions and sustain the pace of automation, it just wasn't there. And the delta between where the staff were and where the technology was just increasing at a huge pace.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, let's talk maritime.
Sure.
So maritime means naval.
Yep.
Is that right? Are they synonyms in a sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So basically things at sea, and there's a few important characteristics, right? Mm-hmm. First of all, there's only a really thin umbilical lifeline, right? You'll have some kind of ship-to-shore communications, but you're on your own as far as protecting and making decisions and available equipment and available tools. Mm-hmm. So you don't have the time to go back to port and ask for help. It's too late by then. So maritime has this sort of isolation quality. And yet at the same time, it's not just one system. These maritime environments are fully self-contained industrial infrastructures and civic infrastructures. They make their own drinking water, they handle their own waste products, they generate their own power, they've got access control systems, they've got obviously their critical production function, whatever that is. And in many cases, they are dealing with highly valuable or even sort of military grade product. So there's an acute sensitivity, and yet for the most part these environments have been sort of overlooked by the industrial security guys, and they've been told, you should do assessments and you should do risk registers on the enterprise technique side, and that's fine, but it doesn't change your ability to respond at that speed of automation, which we believe is so important.
If I looked at a ship-to-shore configuration today, would I find all kinds of proprietary or government-furnished unique stuff, protocols that are non-standard, and
not
legacy stuff? Like,
really.
What runs there now? Is it?
Yeah, I mean, most
is it normal client server?
It's mostly normal client server. I mean, the difference here is, depending on how far offshore you are, you might have satellite comms, you might have point-to-point microwave, you might even have terrestrial 4G or 5G these days, depending on exactly where you are.
Right.
But what tunnels over those transports is important. And clearly, you don't want to have the sort of open door policy where somebody can get onto your comms link and have full access to your infrastructure. Hmm. So there's been some reasonable protection on sort of inbound comms and not allowing just arbitrary browsing. But what we're dealing with are environments with, you know, dozens or hundreds of people, all of whom have trusted access to different parts of it, all of whom with the best will in the world might make a mistake. And so what we look at is, where is the crown jewel? What is the function or the asset that we have to protect above all else? And then you back down from there. You look at, you know, what can we do to ensure that that thing is protected regardless of whatever else might be going on in the vessel.
So in a typical vessel, I'm imagining, there must be the normal sort of sustaining base stuff like entertainment and, you know, email and food and that
Absolutely.
Kind of stuff. But then there's also the the warfighting component, are those things separate? I would imagine that. I would hope they would.
They're supposed to be. What we find is they are, but there's usually an asterisk somewhere floating in that definition.
If you only have satellite comms, then you're using that for both.
Yeah, you're using that as far as data and remote monitoring and logging and analysis. You're using typically the same type of comms link no matter what. Now, you might be pulling satellite TV signals off one of those little dishes. But
As a parallel feed,
but that's an input only, right? The requests, you know, if you do order pay-per-view, that goes out over a comms link somewhere.
Right,
you know, at home, it goes over our internet connection. But on a vessel, it goes over the same satellite backhaul that's being used for mission critical logging and activity monitoring. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, there is some separation for sure. But just like we saw in the industrial environments on land, what we used to believe was a true separation, it's now not necessarily so. And the danger there is you don't necessarily have absolute control and ownership over every communication path that's possible and every inadvertent condition that could be created amongst the hundreds or thousands of connected nodes that run one of these vessels.
Interesting. Now, you guys put out a white paper recently.
We did, yeah. Just last week, we released a white paper that talks about some of these issues and highlights some of the difference between the traditional techniques, which again are sort of passive, reactive, and depend on a human analyst component, versus what we offer in our product set, which is this real-time protection. And it's real-time on that comms link we've talked about, so we would put a remote access tool with inline inspection of all of this native activity on the vessel itself, protecting all the inbound and outbound comms. And we call that product OT Access on-site. And at the same time, we would look at our inline network security appliances, which are SCADA Fuse and SCADA Wall, and they're designed to inspect and isolate critical assets from only the explicitly permitted types of activity at the permitted times and from the permitted points of origin. And so what we're trying to do is ensure that none of these assets get told to do something by accident or maliciously, which we know they're never meant to do. And so we become that last line of defense for all those assets.
So these sound like such important functions. Good question. I know there's probably no accurate answer that covers all cases, but is it usually a green field that you'd be walking into, or would there be some kind of security there, or?
It's expensive to build a platform.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
I'm guessing there's probably some green field.
There is some. I'd love to go in at the design stage for a new rig or a new vessel and be instrumented at the very beginning.
At design time, right.
But the reality is there's thousands of vessels around the world that basically never had significant security infrastructure built in. And those are brownfield, right? Those are existing things where we need to wrap security around what's there. And we can't make it a requirement that you essentially rebuild the whole platform or rebuild the whole ship. There's no budget for that. It's not realistic. So what we have to do is look at what you have and be able to accommodate the activity you're already dependent upon, the assets you've already installed and are using, and the personnel and oversight procedures for the control room, which are keeping things afloat.
Yeah.
And that's one of the advantages, because we have these little point solutions that can be installed all around the network without requiring a single umbrella sort of platform upheaval. We have the ability to identify those critical assets and protect them as part of a standard deployment.
Would encryption be the most likely thing to be there now?
Probably. Encryption and some basic access control. But what we'll see is that, you know, you might have an Active Directory server, which people are using for basic, you know, credential management. But it doesn't spill over into, for example, session control authentication on the production side, because those things don't talk to AD.
Right?
So, you know, yes, you've checked the box that you've got some authentication, but if it's not able to be used, then it's not a complete solution.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to guess that the Navy, as part of DoD, obviously, has compliance regs and standards and maybe some design targets or frameworks that they use, or do they?
The Navy has been looking into this pretty actively for the past 2 or 3 years. And they've probably done more than any of the commercial operators worldwide as far as understanding what the real scope of threats are. They haven't done a lot of public-private partnership yet with industry technology providers. This is something, obviously, that we're very interested in supporting. They've developed a lot of technology in-house, and they've tested it. But, you know, as far as how widely deployed it is, you know, across the fleet, that's classified.
Yeah. So talk about it on YouTube. So architecturally, I'm assuming that as you guys looked at these maritime setups, the Bayshore platform looked like it fit in nicely, at least from a deployment perspective. How would you do it? Would you be imagining dropping appliances on ships, or is it more virtual, or is it a combination?
It's a combination.
So we
start with the inbound and outbound comms. And so there's going to be some consolidation point where comms are pumped onto whatever sort of wireless channel is in use, and there's probably redundant channels. So we have a solution called OT Access, which is available as a self-contained on-site deployment. And what that tool is specifically to allow secure remote access to OT connected assets without exposing the OT network on a VPN or making it otherwise routable from an enterprise or less secure side. So for any inbound communication that needs to, for example, make a diagnostic inquiry to an asset or reconfigure a PLC, OT Access will sit and mitigate whether or not that connection is permitted. It's coming from allowable source, and it's providing function codes at the protocol level, which we know are safe and permissible for the individual asset that's being instructed to make some change. So that's where we start. And there's a server component that sits out in a DMZ somewhere and sort of handles the inbound connections. And then it provides a proxy function into the OT space on the vessel.
That would probably be terrestrial?
Well, the inbound comms are terrestrial, but our termination server is on the vessel.
On the vessel.
Absolutely.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. So we previously offered this as a hosted solution for distributed enterprise. But the request from the maritime industry was, look, I want to use this, but it has to be on board, right? We have to provide all of the security enforcement under our own sort of operating umbrella.
Interesting.
And so that was why we launched OT Access on-site just in the past couple of months in order to offer that capability.
Yeah.
So that's the first part.
Yeah.
And now from there, again, we're interested in the industrial assets, the OT assets specifically. So from there, what we look at is down in the production space, whether it's oil and gas and handling crude or dealing with some sort of material handling for another product on board, or the civic infrastructure components, the desalination, the water treatment, the wastewater, the power generation, all these other industrial processes. What we're looking at is ensuring that that vessel continues to operate safely and without risk of takeover. And so we use a product called SCADAfuse to do that. And SCADAfuse learns what all the normal activities are between all these different components, and it looks at what your control systems are telling them to do. Once we've learned what those normal things are, we define any exceptions, any schedule-based maintenance windows, anything like this. Thereafter, if there's anything which deviates from that, it's blocked and an alert is generated, and the control room on the ship sees that in real time. So there's no sort of alert fatigue where you're dealing with hundreds of accumulated notices and you don't know what to do with them. We are only alerting when there's a specific probable cause of a threat to one of these assets. And we block that out. We say, look, okay, this has happened. Here's what it was. Here's where it came from. And the answer may be, okay, actually, we need to incorporate that into the policy, in which case it's one click, boom, click it, and you allow it going forward. Or you see, okay, something went wrong here, and it was perhaps malicious, perhaps accidental, but still potentially catastrophic. And in either case, the recommendation is that because a blocking event took place, that's where the escalation needs to happen. After the decision to block, which we already knew as a result of the automated analysis in the product.
You know, we started with the idea that ship to shore has these vulnerabilities. So I have this image of like a kid with a laptop trying to hack a ship out somewhere.
It's happened.
Would this setup kind of, it would thwart that,
you
because
know,
the gateway would detect the anomalies.
It would, absolutely. And it's not a pipe dream. You know, when I was in college, we could hit satellites in orbit because there were open gateways that you could connect to.
You're not confessing now, are
you? No, never did anything bad to them, but it was there. There was no control of any sort on this incredibly expensive communications network. So we want to make sure that, you know, okay, if somebody can send an email and, you know, communicate with somebody on board, that's fine and that's permitted. But if somebody starts to try and poke around and gain unauthorized access to a critical system on that vessel or that platform, we absolutely don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
And you can't afford to discover it the next morning. By then, it's way too late.
How's the reception been with the government? I know you've been talking to some of the teams in the Navy. I would imagine they would like this.
Yeah, absolutely. They're very interested in it. I mean, one of the things that they asked about was what kind of latency. Because when we're doing full deep packet inspection.
Good point.
Yeah, clearly there's a performance consideration. And, you know, we can do fully loaded, sustained throughput inspection on these OT protocols in 100 microseconds or less.
Wow.
And that's at a sort of 100,000 packets per second throughput. So it's an incredible performance number, right? And this is because we, as I said at the beginning, we're vetted. We've been building this technology for 7 years now. And it's been vetted in real military grade or critical infrastructure grade deployments. This isn't just repackaged open source tools. We built this all in-house.
I would imagine the same architecture applies to other multi-node kind of applications in OT.
Absolutely.
But I know there are a lot of unique problems in maritime.
Well, the interesting thing with maritime, above and beyond the technology platform, is the fact that generally everybody is either an employee or a contractor, and as such, they're all bound by a common set of rules, which means that enforcement is part of the culture. Mm-hmm. And there's lots of enforcement on sort of soft violations. You know, somebody didn't put the keys back, or somebody piggybacked through when you'd carted through a door. And there's video cameras, and there's surveillance, and all the other techniques. And the idea is to identify and eliminate those risks immediately. But historically, there hasn't been the same level of culture of enforcement on network level activity. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're bringing. You know, we're not prescribing a standard of security which is unfamiliar. We're simply extending it into the most critical function of the vessel itself.
Well, I certainly hope you're successful deploying this everywhere. It seems like something that's pretty necessary for our naval fleet and for our for all of DoD.
Yeah, absolutely.
I hope you guys sell barrelfuls of these things. And I appreciate you stopping by and sharing. I always like learning something from you when you come by to visit with us.
Thanks very much, Ed. We're always glad to come.
It's fantastic.
Take care.
To see you.
Cheers.
And we'll see you next time.